greetings. We want to welcome all of those that are here today in our sanctuary and those that are online. There is a Methodist baptism outside, and it's kind of sprinkling. Well, is it coming down a little bit stronger than that right now?
Yeah.
Just a little bit. But anyway, we are so glad to have you. Once again, my name is Wally Williams here at Good Shepherd, and we are so delighted to have you in worship. Let me mention a couple of announcements, if I would. First of all, church reservations. If you're worshiping with us online and would like to join us for in-person worship service, please call or email for reservation. Yes, we do require a mask that you have to wear. Also, the holiday food for December, the collection, the list is in the newsletter or on the ACO Food Bank page. And so we encourage you to do that. Let us go to the Lord, if we would, with our prayer time together. Let's open with prayer. Father God, thank you for being with us in this place. Thank you for visiting this planet in the person of Jesus Christ, being the incarnation, and now you're present with us, even in this sanctuary through your Holy Spirit. So Father, bless us and speak to us, we pray, in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Amen. At this time, we will light the Advent candle. We lit the first candle, the candle of peace, and then we lit the candle of hope. And today, we light the candle of joy. And the candle of joy is also known as the rose candle. And John and Kathy are going to come and lead us in this lighting. And so, John, I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to you.
We light this rose candle as a symbol of Christ, who is our joy, the divine made full present in the human life. May the light sent from God shine in the darkness to show us the way of salvation, that the keeping of Advent may open our hearts to God's joy, and that the light of Christ may penetrate the darkness of sin, that this wreath may constantly remind us to prepare for the coming of Christ, that the Christmas season may fill us with peace and joy as we strive to follow the example of Jesus.
Loving God, your church joyfully awaits the coming of its Savior, who enlightens our hearts and dispels the darkness of ignorance and sin. Pour forth your blessing upon us as we light the candles, this wreath. May their light reflect the splendor of Christ, who is the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Amen. This time I'm going to ask you to go ahead and stand together, and Tom is going to lead us as we enter our worship, as we are called by God to worship. And so we're going to ask Tom to come on up. While he's coming, I do want to make as the finance chairman, I do want to encourage everyone to make sure that their pledges are in. And if you have turned in your pledge, thank you very much. The pledge cards are on the back table. Yes, Tom?
Thank you. Good morning. Please join me as we read responsibly the call to worship. How can we keep still this day?
There is joy in this place.
God's steadfast love extends to everyone.
God reaches out to us in all forgiveness and compassion.
Thanks to God for all the wonderful blessings we have received.
Let us celebrate God's joyful love for us.
For and with us.
With us. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Tom. Wally today is going to be preaching on the many names or the nicknames of Jesus. So this song, I chose to sing this song. You may not be familiar with it. It's fairly new, but it's a simple melody. I played it for Prelude, if anybody was listening. So at least you can say you've heard it once. But I'm sure you'll pick up on it, and it's just a real sweet little song. Wonderful, merciful Savior.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit, we long to embrace. You offer hope. Lost away. Oh, we hopelessly lost the way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, always hunger for. Almighty infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here in our weakness you find us falling before your throne. Oh,
of prayer, and we need to pray for individuals. We need to pray for Daryl and Carrie and her family, and Betty and Amelia, Amy, Chrissy, the Utley family, Matthew, Lisa, Bill, and Gary as he had his knee replaced yesterday. And of course, we do want to pray for you, Dick, as you have surgery Fridays, I believe. This Friday, and so we need to pray for Dick as he has a hip replacement. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God and our Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we give you thanks and praise for being our God, for being a compassionate God, for being a caring God, for being a consoling God. And we ask, Lord, that as we enter your presence this day, you might speak to us through your Holy Spirit here in the congregation here, Good Shepherd, and those online as well. We give you praise and thanks. We ask, Lord, that you would just bless this Christmas season and bless us as we deal with this season of coronavirus. Give us strength and patience. Help us to be all healthy, and we will give you the praise and thanksgiving for that. Father, be with us as we share together in song and in prayer and by hearing your word this day, and we will give you the praise in Jesus' name. Now be with us as we share together the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples as they prayed. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
Lord, listen to your children pray. Spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children pray. Send us love, send us power, send us praise.
Let's all stand and sing the First Noel.
Stand again.
The first Noel.
Apostles' Creed, and Tom will come and lead us in that.
Yes, please join me in this reading. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you very much. You may be seated. Our scripture comes from the book of Isaiah, the Old Testament, where he prophesies concerning the various nicknames of Jesus. And we're going to be reading verses 6 and 7, which is very traditional during the Christmas time. Let us go ahead and hear verse 6 and 7 from Isaiah chapter 9. It says, "For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from this time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this." May God add his blessings to the reading and our hearing of his holy inspired word to our hearts this day. You know, we are in a sermon series concerning the nicknames of Jesus, and we are looking at Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. And as we look at these nicknames, I'm reminded of a situation. But before we look at that situation and that experience that I had as a child, let's just pray together. Gracious God, we give you thanks for your scripture. We give you thanks that you saw this world in a condition and you wanted to do something about it, and so you sent someone to rescue us. So, Father, we ask, Lord, that you would just bless us as we look at your word and that our lives are changed. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, when I was a child, I had the opportunity to play baseball. I love baseball. And my coach assigned nicknames for all the players, especially the infield. The shortstop, his name was Carrot Top for obvious reasons. He had red hair, bright red hair. The third baseman was, his nickname was Bullet. Bullet. Because he had such a bullet arm and he could throw a baseball just a line drive over there, and it was just a great one. And our second baseman was called Freckles, and I don't have to go into that. I think you know that. Second baseman was Freckles, and I played first base. And the coach's nickname for me was Eyebrows. I don't know why he would call me Eyebrows. I think I was born with these. But each of these nicknames are descriptive in nature, and they really describe who we are. And maybe you have a pet that you have, and you have nicknamed that pet. Maybe you yourself have a nickname. Maybe other people call you something. That's your nickname that describes you. But Isaiah gave some nicknames to Jesus, and we will look at them. And if you want to know the sermon outline, here it is: Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. And that is verse 6. And so if you want to know when I'm done and whenever I land this plane, I'm going to be on number four, Prince of Peace. And so let's look at these names together. Let's just kind of walk through these names together. First one is the Wonderful Counselor. Verse 6 says, his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor. Now, not only was the life of Jesus wonderful, not only was the resurrection wonderful, not only was his birth wonderful, his grace today for each of us is wonderful. You know, if I had anything to do with his birth, I would have him born in a sterile hospital, much less a feeding trough or a stable. I wouldn't have him born there. And I always ask myself this question, why did God bypass Rome? That would have been a good place for Jesus to be born. Why not Athens? But a dusty little town called Bethlehem? Why would he do that? But I'm forced to realize that God's thoughts are higher than my thoughts. His ways are different than my ways. Now, as we look at the Wonderful Counselor, we focus on the word counselor. And that means one who gives great advice. And a friend told me that his father was offered some land in 1956. And his father offered my father an opportunity to invest in this land. It was 20 years ago, and it was 20 acres. No, I'm sorry. No, it was 60 years ago, excuse me, and 20 acres. And the land at that time cost $2,000. And the fellow didn't know how sound his advice was when he offered that land to my father. My father said, no, I'm not going to do it. $2,000 is a lot of money in 1956. I just can't do it. But do y'all know where North Park is? That was the land. That land is worth millions and millions and millions of dollars. I would have been set for life, you might want to say. Advice. The mission statement of the North Texas Conference is to make disciples for the transformation of the world. So the question comes to us, will you help somebody to invest in the Wonderful Counselor? There are so many people in Lucas outside these walls who need to be introduced to the Wonderful Counselor. And that might be by simple doing good deeds for Christ, in the name of Christ. So that is the Wonderful Counselor and the wonderful advice that we can give other people. The second name is Mighty God. And when the baby was born in Bethlehem, something mighty, something very powerful happened. You know, several years ago, my family went to Niagara Falls. My personal family did, and we visited Niagara Falls from the Canadian side. Has anybody here been to Niagara? Isn't it beautiful? Isn't it just, it's just an awesome experience. When you go to Niagara Falls, and of course, we were taking pictures and doing various things, and there was a door to the side. I was about 30, and there was a door to the side, and I was kind of a renegade, you know. I was a maverick there at 30. And anyway, there was a door, and it said, it didn't say do not enter, but there was a door there. And so I just kind of snuck away from my family, and I opened that door, and there were stairs that was going, and I walked down those stairs. And my family was up there taking pictures and doing all kinds of things. Kitty and the kids were doing all the stuff, and they were sitting there watching the falls, and I was going down these stairs. And I entered a platform. I stood on a platform that was 20 feet away. There was no protection or whatever. I could have stuck my hand out and felt water. I mean tons and tons and tons of water came down that area. It was just overwhelming. I am told that there's enough water that goes over Niagara Falls that fills 1 million bathtubs every second. That's a lot of water, you know it? Every second, several million have happened just by my sharing this. It is amazing. And the power of God, you multiply that by infinity, and that's the power of God. It is amazing the power that God has. And so you might be in a situation right now, whether it be financial, whether it be emotional, physical, relational, spiritual, He has enough power to handle that. You know, in the Bible study that we're involved in, we're talking about Jesus' miracles. And last week we talked about how He fed the 5,000. And then we talked about how He's healed the blind and the lame, how He has walked on water, how He calmed the storm. We are reminded in that group that God has an extraordinary amount of power. And Matthew says, and somebody needs to hear this, nothing is impossible with God. Nothing. Clap out loud there. Nothing is impossible with God. That is an awesome experience when you think that He can wrap His mind around the difficulties that we have to shoulder, and that nothing is impossible with God. So there's a question. Do you feel that you're in an impossible situation? Do you need to be rescued by the mighty God? I know I do. Sometimes all of us do. The third name is Everlasting Father. That name speaks of a relationship. A relationship that we can have with our Heavenly Father. You know, God is not some entity out there, some thing in the cosmos that we can refer to from time to time in church. But God is a personal God that we can have a relationship with. The good news of the Bible is that God is approachable, and nothing is more difficult or too difficult for God to handle. We are familiar with the story of the prodigal son in Luke 15, how he leaves the father. And to make a long story short, he ends up feeding the pigs. And he wants to eat some things that the pigs are eating. And then he realizes how lonely he is and he needs a relationship. And he says, maybe I need to go back and apologize to my father. And so he goes back and the father notices him from a distance and says, I recognize that walk. I know who that is. And he goes up and he hugs and embraces the son. That tells us that God wants to have a deep and abiding relationship with us. And it's not just something that we go through the order of worship, but He wants to have a relationship, a personal relationship with you. That's why He came down to this planet in the form of a baby, to have a relationship with you and with me. That's what grace is all about. You know, we sing that song, Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound. Oh, that was such an expression of God's grace, revealing Himself to this world in the form of a baby. And then the last name is the Prince of Peace. The Prince of Peace. You know, the opposite of peace is what? war. Now today, every person on this globe is at war. It might not be a physical war, but it's a spiritual war. It's a spiritual war, a war inside. A war of hopelessness and loneliness. The war inside can be just overwhelming and mind-numbing. But the good news of the gospel tells us that this war can be victoriously won by ourselves. We can win that war. That Christ is with us always through the Holy Spirit. So again, a question. Do you need or do you know anybody that needs peace? Peace within. Peace in their spirit. Peace in their heart. Peace in their family. Do you know anybody that needs peace? Now, this right here is a music box. My wife, being a musician, Mark, loves music boxes. We have them all over the house during Christmas. This one is the lion lays down with a lamb, and it has a baby Jesus there. It's taken from the book of Revelations. It still works. I could twist it, but I couldn't turn it off. But anyway, the lion lays down with the lamb. Now, the natural inclination of a lion is to devour the lamb. It is the enemy of the lamb. But through Jesus Christ, the lion can be at peace with the lamb. Two forces can be at peace with one another. And if there's any time that we need calmness, it's now. We need to realize that there is hope that is available. This pandemic, a lot of people are suffering from COVID frustration. Being inside all the time. But there is hope in Jesus the Christ. And so I'm just going to just ask the question. Do you know anybody that needs the wonderful counselor? Do you need the wonderful counselor? Do you know anybody that needs a God that is so mighty, so powerful, that can encompass and wrap his arms around all of the difficulties that we have? An everlasting Father, a relationship that is possible through Jesus Christ. Do you know anybody that needs that? Do you know someone that needs a Prince of Peace? That needs a peace inside? Jesus said, "Peace I give to you. My peace I leave with you, not as the world gives, but as I give." Do you know anybody that needs that peace? Maybe you need that peace. Maybe you need that peace. I need that peace. Let's just pray together and thank God for being the wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Father, we thank you. We praise your holy name for all that you have said and all that you have done. We thank you that those aren't nicknames, but those describe your attributes. They describe your personality. For you are the wonderful counselor and the mighty God, everlasting Father, and yes, the Prince of Peace. Bless Good Shepherd as we give you praise for being that type of God. And we will give you the praise and the adoration in Jesus' precious name. Amen. And amen. This time we're going to go into our offering. And we are not able to pass the plate right now for obvious reasons. But the baskets are located in the entry and the exit. And if you would like to place a special gift in there to help out the church in any way that we receive it, I would ask you to do that. Those at home can give in through the mail, can give online through PayPal, or drop it off here at the church. Whatever you would like to do, our mailbox is locked, and so that is helpful. But let us enter into prayer as we think about what we're going to give.
The skies of Bethlehem appeared a star, while angels sang to lowly shepherds. Three wise men seeking truth traveled from afar, hoping to find the child from heaven. Falling on their knees, they bowed before the home Prince of Peace. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you.
Power of Jesus' name, let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Let's sing.
Let us receive our benediction. Gracious God and our Father, thank you for being the wonderful counselor and the mighty God and the everlasting Father, as well as the Prince of Peace. And give us the peace and the strength that we need to go through this week. And may we come back in Jesus' name next week. We thank you in his name. Amen. And amen.
come.